December 15th, 1791. The first 10 amendments to the U.S. Constitution, the Bill of Rights, was ratified by the states. The Great American Experiment was underway. The notion that people would govern themselves was unprecedented. There were no models, no examples to choose from. For the first time, men enacted into law human rights, not just government-given rights. The authors deemed those rights so important, they made a provision to protect those rights so they could never be taken away. The Second Amendment.
A well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, shall not be infringed.
Time and time again, history replays itself. Unarmed civilizations fall prey to tyrannical leaders. To ensure the balance of power remains in the hands of the people, the framers of the Second Amendment crafted 27 words. One sentence. To succinctly and definitively protect our freedoms from controlling political groups, oppressive religious organizations, or from an abusive government. None of those carefully chosen 27 words are unusual. The sentence is straightforward and crystal clear. There is no mention of limitations or restrictions on the type of arms citizens can carry. There is no mention of gun control. No distinction between sporting use and military use. No language regarding handguns, shotguns, rifles, or even weaponry not yet imagined. What the authors of the Second Amendment did specify is the right of the people, not privilege, to keep and bear arms. Yet, for more than 200 years, those 27 words and their intended meaning have been debated. What's the debate? We, the people, will decide. Here are six facts every American must know about the Second Amendment, often referred to as 2A. Fact number one. The framers of the Bill of Rights believed in God. They fought for the freedom from religious persecution. They believed the right to self-defense is a fundamental God-given right that existed long before the creation of any government. In fact, written documents pertaining to self-preservation predate the Second Amendment by thousands of years. Reference to the right to freedom from violent harm and the right to self-defense is found in the Torah and Christian Bible in Exodus 22, verse 2. In Jewish law, the Talmud states, if someone comes to kill you, arise quickly and kill him. Roman Catholic doctrine has long asserted,
someone who defends his life is not guilty of murder, even if he is forced to deal his aggressor a lethal blow.
Protestant theologian Samuel Rutherford writes in his 1644 publication, Lex Rex,
"Because no king or civil power can take away nature's birthright of self-defense from any man or a community of men."
Even the Declaration of Independence, written 15 years before the Second Amendment was ratified, clearly states,
"All human beings are endowed with certain unalienable rights, and that governments are created to protect those rights."
So, what exactly is an unalienable right? A right that cannot be transferred or taken away. Fact number two.
The right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed.
The language of the Second Amendment prohibits the federal government from infringing on the rights of the people. As clear as the First Amendment's language of prohibiting Congress from infringing on the right of the people to religious expression, freedom of speech, and freedom of the press, the Second Amendment is also clearly a protector of rights. Former Texas legislator Dr. Susanna Hupp knows infringement firsthand. Her parents were brutally gunned down in a Texas cafeteria by a lone gunman.
Reported subject shot 15 shots into the...
The only thing that the gun laws did that day in Texas was keep people like me from being able to protect myself and my family.
Due to a Texas state law prohibiting the carrying of firearms, the handgun that may have saved her parents' lives remained in her car.
As odd as this may sound to you, I wasn't angry at the madman that did this, but I was mad as hell at my legislators because they had legislated me out of the right to protect myself and my family.
Fact number three.
A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state.
The Second Amendment refers to a well-regulated militia. The right of the people to form citizen militias was unquestioned by the founders. Alexander Hamilton, in the Federalist Papers number 28, expressed,
"When a government betrays the people by amassing too much power and becoming tyrannical, the people have no choice but to exercise their original right of self-defense, to fight the government."
In the Federalist Papers number 46, James Madison, the father of the Bill of Rights, argues,
"The ultimate authority resides in the people, and that if the federal government got too powerful and overstepped its authority, then the people would develop plans of resistance and resort to arms."
Some interpret today's National Guard as the well-regulated militia. But the founders opposed anything but a small national military.
There are some people that think that that phrase in the Second Amendment has an entirely different meaning.
The phrase well-regulated refers to a well-trained, prepared, and disciplined citizens' militia.
They seem to think that it means just the state National Guard, and they don't know their history. That's just not true.
The phrase was in common use in 1791 and for more than a century afterwards. The Oxford English Dictionary from that time period defines well-regulated as something that was calibrated correctly, functioning as expected. Fact number four.
A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people.
Further evidence that a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state does not refer to the National Guard is supported by recent research.
The writing style of the late 18th century legal documents typically began with a preamble. The purpose of the preamble was to state a purpose, not a limitation. New Hampshire's Constitution, written in 1784, begins with a preamble. The liberty of the press is essential to the security of freedom in a state. It ought therefore to be inviolably preserved. The Constitution has a preamble.
We the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic trade.
The Bill of Rights has a preamble.
The conventions of a number of the states, having at the time of their adopting the Constitution, expressed a desire in order to prevent misconstruction or abuse of its powers, that further declaratory and restrictive clauses should be added.
Since a preamble states a purpose,
a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people.
The well-regulated militia only reinforces the importance of the individual right to keep and carry arms.
The Second Amendment, when it really comes down to it, I believe it has two primary meanings. One is the obvious ability for me to be able to protect myself and my family from bad guys. But there's another meaning that the founders put in place that I think is absolutely vital to our way of life in this country. It's the ability for all of us out here to be able to protect ourselves from a government that could become tyrannical.
Fact number 5. Before the war between the states, some states enacted laws that made it illegal for slaves and freed African Americans to possess firearms. In the infamous Dred Scott case, the Supreme Court ruled in 1857 that people of African ancestry could not claim U.S. citizenship, essentially taking away the right of African Americans to own a gun. In truth, armed slaves would be able to retaliate against their owners. Ironically, even though the framers of the Second Amendment feared becoming slaves to their government, some were tragically willing to permit slavery. Now that slavery is abolished, all citizens of all races should enjoy the Second Amendment's legal protection. Fact number 6. Over the past 60 years, the interpretation of the term well-regulated militia has come under fire from the Federal Circuit Courts of Appeal and many lower court judges. Those judges have wrongly ruled that the right to keep and bear arms doesn't apply to individuals, but have wrongly interpreted militia to mean the National Guard. But the words well-regulated militia had a far different meaning at the time the Second Amendment was written. In today's world, well-regulated is associated with intense government regulation. At the time the Second Amendment was drafted, the term didn't need to be defined. Colonial militias had been in existence for 150 years. With the exception of millers, ferrymen, and slaves, every adult male was required to join. It was your duty to report for service 4 to 6 times a year. You were required to have your own musket, bayonet, ammunition, and knapsack. If you were unable to supply your own firearm, the militia would provide you with one. Militias were well organized, well regulated, with the men reporting to an appointed captain. Not only did you have the right to own a firearm, it was your duty. Although the Constitution gave Congress the power to raise and support a temporary army, the framers feared a standing army after the Revolutionary War. The overriding purpose of the Second Amendment in guaranteeing the right of the people to keep and bear arms was to maintain a check on the standing army. A well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, meant ultimate power must be in the hands of the people. The Second Amendment is very specific about this. It is the right of the people, not the states, to keep and bear arms. Recently, the Supreme Court confirmed this view in the District of Columbia versus Heller, finding the right to keep and bear arms an individual right held by the people, not a collective right, as it's been interpreted previously. The court concluded,
Americans have an individual right to possess a firearm unconnected with service in a militia, and to use that arm for traditionally lawful purposes, such as self-defense within the home.
Without a doubt, the Supreme Court decision is a victory. Portions of the court document affirm the facts. The individual right to self-defense. Individual rights shall not be infringed. The correct interpretation of a well-regulated militia. But other portions of that same court document contradict the facts.
Like most rights, the Second Amendment is not unlimited. It is not a right to keep and carry any weapon whatsoever, in any manner whatsoever, and for whatever purpose.
Clearly, the controversy is not over. The decision speaks from both sides of the mouth and leaves the door wide open to misinterpretation.
I think it opens it up for all kinds of regulations and registrations of guns that I think do not bode well for the future of the Second Amendment.
Lower courts are likely to interpret the doublespeak and uphold prohibitions on carrying concealed weapons. Lower courts are likely to interpret the doublespeak and uphold laws imposing conditions and restrictions on the sale of firearms. Lower courts are likely to interpret the doublespeak and uphold bans on dangerous and unusual weapons, which could include any weapon the court wants it to be. The debate over the Second Amendment is far from over. Ultimately, we, the people, must decide what's more important, our unalienable rights, or what the Supreme Court decides are our rights. So what is it every American should know? Gun control laws have been in existence for hundreds of years. Gun control infringes on individual rights that have been in existence for thousands of years. Gun control is necessary when one group of people wants to control or dominate another group of people. Gun control is usually popularized by myth.
You know, we constantly hear these myths about gun control out there. There's a myth that gun control saves lives. I'm a perfect example of the fact that that isn't true. There's a myth that we'd be safer with fewer guns. We have to have guns in the right hands. There's a myth that countries with gun control laws have lower crime. There's a myth that carrying concealed weapons leads to higher crime and accident rates. It's not true. And registering guns, in my opinion, it's always the precursor to confiscation, which means that I can't protect myself or my family.
There is much evidence that proves more guns in the hands of more law-abiding citizens actually deters crime and lowers the homicide rate. Registering guns does little to keep guns out of the hands of criminals. Many cities with the strictest gun control laws often have the highest crime rate per capita. When criminals have guns and law-abiding citizens are disarmed, who are the gun control laws really protecting?
It's about rights, and as long as you are exercising your right in a responsible manner, I don't think we should be placing regulations upon how you exercise that right.
We the people have the unalienable self-right to defend and protect ourselves. We, the people, have the unalienable individual right to pick up arms to secure a free state. We, the people, have the unalienable right to possess and own any weapon we choose. From muskets to military-style weapons, the Second Amendment protects that right.
One of the great things about the ability to keep and bear arms is that ultimately, as long as we have that ability, ultimately the people will have the power and make the decisions.
You and 2A. Good for the USA.
It's your right, your responsibility, defending life, defending liberty from kings and tyrants, murderers and thieves. So spread the word till all have heard. One guarantee will keep us free. They put quill in the parchment so we'd understand. Keep the power in the people's hands.
A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed.